11th meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2024. I would like to record our thanks to Kate Forbes for her thoughtful and diligent approach as a member of this committee and wish her well when she takes up her new post later this afternoon. Our first agenda item is a decision in taking business in private. Our first, are members content to take business in private? Thank you. Our next agenda item is to continue to take evidence on the committee's review into the review of the EU-UK Trade and Cooperation Agreement, the TCA. We have two panels this morning, and we are firstly joined in person by Gareth Williams, Head of Policy for Prosper, Catherine McWilliam, National Director of the Institute of Directors Scotland, and online we are joined by Kate Foster, Senior International Affairs Advisor for the Federation of Small Business, and William Bain, Head of Trade Policy, British Chambers of Commerce. And a warm welcome to you all this morning. If I could open with a question, just to get a sense from you all, and thank you for the submissions that did come in, but what are the current challenges in trading with the EU? What would you like to see in a review of the TCA, and which issues your members would prioritise? Just what the challenges ahead that you see might be on the horizon as well. So there's a lot in that one, but I'll go to Mr. Bain first. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. The British Chambers of Commerce produces an annual document in which we survey members. Our most recent publication was produced at the end of December last year. And we had the results of survey data from over 700 businesses in every part of the UK. And what we were finding in that is that 60% of exporters to the EU said it was more difficult to trade with the EU than it had been a year ago. 49% of companies don't feel that the current TCA is enabling them to grow or increase their sales. And the problems are rooted in a variety of sectors. So for small businesses, there's a requirement in terms of VAT on things like online sales. So to use the EU's import one-stop shop, you need to have a fiscal representative in the EU. And that's very burdensome and costly for small businesses. So that's been an ongoing problem really since 2021, which has not been resolved. So that's something we would like to see changed. And we believe it could be done really in the short term through the specialised committees, if the political will's there. We're also experiencing real problems in terms of agri-food. So the requirements for export health certificates, for checks on goods going from the UK or GB in particular into the European Union have added vast amounts of bureaucracy and cost for agri-food traders. So having some kind of agreement that mitigates or eliminates some of those extra costs would be really beneficial. On mobility issues, there are sectors of the economy like care, hospitality, health service, where there are clear pressures that have come from the restrictions on mobility since 2021. We believe two forms of agreement would be useful here. One, an agreement on youth mobility, that would allow for movement for functions like training, employment. And then also, I think there are restrictions around business mobility that could be looked at as well, increasing the number of days that people can spend working in the other market, widening the range of activities that are permissible as well when visiting the other market for business purposes. And the third issue, we would say, needs urgent action by the UK government, the European Commission, is in relation to the forthcoming full implementation of the EU's carbon border adjustment mechanism. And the BCC has significant concerns that areas within scope of this, which include steel, iron, aluminium, other regulated goods sectors, could face severe effects if we don't have linkage of the emissions trading schemes between the EU and the UK. So those are really the three priorities we would have for the TCA review.
Thank you. Can I bring in Ms. Foster? Thanks.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for the invitation to speak to the committee this morning. If I can start by taking us back briefly to January 2021 and when we first formally left the single market. We welcomed the agreement of the TCA. We welcomed avoiding the uncertainty that would have come with a no-deal Brexit. But immediately, SMEs had significant barriers to contend with despite the agreement of the formal trade agreement. And that ranged from navigating customs, paperwork and VAT. There were impacts for business mobility, as William alluded to, although obviously we were still experiencing COVID lockdowns at that point. There was recognition, issues around the recognition of certification, around things like product safety, conformity, things like that, plus additional upfront costs, things like handling fees, extra shipping fees, things that appeared on invoices that weren't there before, you know, all to do with the, around the introduction of those new formal steps. And over time since then, many of our SMEs have found ways to work with the new system. They've made new arrangements. They've, you know, changed their business patterns. And we tracked for the first, for the 8 quarters following January 21 in our Small Business Index survey, we asked our members how their trade activity with the EU had changed. And the number of SMEs that said they'd stopped trading temporarily with the EU, that at January, at Q1 21, sorry, it was around 2 in 10 of our SME exporters said they'd stopped trading with the EU temporarily. That's now fallen to 1 in 10. So then there were a number of businesses who held off trading with the EU. They paused activity temporarily, but they've since restarted. There is, however, a significant number that have stopped trading permanently with the EU, and that the last time we asked members about that in Q4 22, that was around 4 to 5%. But we know from speaking to members, anecdotal evidence, that they do find trade with Europe more difficult than before, and William touched on this as well. Even if they are finding ways around, for instance, we have a member who's based up in Skye, and they send things via post to the EU. They recently had an issue when sending a package to Belgium that even though they could zero rate their products in the UK, because Belgium charges import VAT, because the Belgian postal system charges a customs handling fee, there are still those additional costs, which, while on the face of it, they might seem small, they have a cumulative effect, particularly for small businesses that don't have a lot of extra resource. They're working on tight margins. So we have a concern that there is a longer term chilling effect on trade with Europe. And then returning to your original question around what we would want to see in a review, I think traditionally there is a low SME take up of preferential market access. So I think separate to the bones of the TCA, if you like, there is still a piece of work to be done around boosting SME take up of preferential market terms, and that's not unique to the TCA. That's true of all bilateral trade agreements. I think within the TCA, there's room for full implementation of structures that were already there. For instance, the TCA makes provision for setting up an SME committee, which would provide a forum for small business concerns to be aired and maybe resolved between UK government and the European Commission. And that still hasn't been set up. And that's something that we'd really like to see taken forward, even outside the scope of a review. William referred to the VAT representative to allow small businesses to make use of the import one-stop shop. And I won't expand on that any further because William's already covered it, but that's one of our priorities as well. We would also support, if there was scope for a separate veterinary agreement to reduce some of the SPS checks, particularly with the border target operating model coming in, we're going to see the impact of those full import controls coming in. Youth mobility and business mobility is also a priority of ours. So our priorities are quite similar to the points that William made.
Thank you very much. Catherine, would you like to come in next?
Thank you very much, and thank you very much for having me today. It's my first ever evidence session, so I'm hoping you'll all be nice to me. Similar to colleagues, the IOD has a monthly policy voice survey that we issue to our members, and the data that I'll refer to is from June 2023. So in that survey, our members cited the trading relationship with the EU as set out in the TCA as the biggest challenge in the export environment. Reducing friction at the EU-UK border should be at the forefront of any export strategy. With that in mind, 46% of our members indicated that they're finding the trading relationship with the EU challenging, and 72% referred to the fact that this refers to mobility and travel. Changes to customs were also cited as contributing to the challenges as well. So going into that in a bit more detail, most helpful actions that government could take could be to pursue an agreement with the EU on business mobility and visa rules, and that's linked directly to another issue that we're experiencing in terms of access to talent and skills. 27% of our members have responded that they are facing difficulties in hiring staff due to a shortfall in EU applicants, and 10% are finding it harder to recruit unskilled workers. Back in 2021, we asked a similar question, and 38% responded that they were experiencing skills issues due to a lack of applications from EU recruits. Similarly, looking, as colleagues have also picked up, changes to customs procedures are also causing significant issues. 57% of our members who import or export are finding custom changes implemented by the TCA challenging. Businesses are spending more time and more money on Brexit-related paperwork, and often if you look at you know, kind of specific examples in specific countries, paperwork is complex to understand. It varies from state to member state and often has to be completed in the destination country's language. So as Kate has picked up, that is of particular relevance to our small businesses. Anecdotally, we are also seeing that some of our larger members are looking at exporting out with the EU because that is simply easier for them. And I think one of the things that we have heard again anecdotally when we've been out talking to members is that more examples of the how and best practice and successful case studies would be really helpful. Our members have welcomed the SDI-DBT partnership and the Export Academy. That has been viewed to be very helpful, and we would like to see more development there. I think there's also a point for our members around the media coverage of Brexit and implications. You know, imagery of lorries sitting for long periods of time in Kent and Dover. You know, a lot of our members, you know, are asking themselves, what is the point and is it worth it? In terms of what we would look for, what we would ask for, pursuing an individual agreement with the EU on business mobility and extending the 90-day in every 180 limit on travel into the EU in terms of mobility, and to expedite plans for the implementation of the single trade window and use the platform to produce regular reports based on data collection to inform future developments of technology in line with business needs.
Thank you. Gareth, would you like to come in?
Thank you, and thanks for the invitation to give evidence this morning. I don't want to reiterate what my colleagues have already said, and I know the committee's taken a lot of evidence already from trade associations on the challenges facing exporters, particularly in the food and drink area, for example. So, you know, just to add to what's been said around the challenges, obviously, many exporters faced additional costs, complexities, timescale issues, which affected business models and supply chain models. a lot of those challenges were related to implementation and not simply the agreement itself, and differing interpretations across different EU states and authorities. And some of that may be related to a lack of understanding, but some to some deliberate unhelpfulness. Companies responded in a variety of different ways. For some businesses, these new difficulties are a fact of life, but others have continued to trade and accepted those extra administrative and handling and storage costs. That has reduced competitiveness, and I think another issue that many are facing now is that they have started to lose customers in the EU based on perceptions of the extra difficulties of doing business with UK-based suppliers. Turning to our priorities for improving the current position, we would very much take the view that the TCA is a welcome floor, but it's certainly not the ceiling. We would like to see action to improve implementation in the short term. Looking further ahead, we recognise that the EU has probably higher priorities than the review of the TCA at present, and may be inclined to take more of a minimalist approach to the review. Nonetheless, we think there is scope to make improvements, particularly if we focus around those mutual benefits and mutual areas of interest. So that's what we are encouraging. We would like to see progress around a veterinary agreement, mutual recognition of professional qualifications is also very important for a range of different sectors. We've had reference already to the carbon border adjustment mechanism, but I would add in more widely cooperation around energy issues, whether that's in relation to offshore wind or hydrogen or carbon capture and storage, all those areas of opportunity that we would like to see developed as part of the forthcoming Green Industrial Strategy. Business travel and youth mobility have also been highlighted already. We welcome the agreement on Horizon Europe, but we now need to make sure that we make the most of that so that there's a strong case to continue in association in the future, but also obviously to get as much economic and wider benefits as possible. The area of regulation is of interest to a range of our members across different sectors. There are concerns around divergence, so how do we cooperate on these areas in the longer term, and financial services is an example there. And lastly, just to mention issues around rules of origin and the impact that has on some products and some sectors, not only in relation to exports into Europe, but the impact on exports globally. We are members of the UK-EU Domestic Advisory Group on the TCA, and a number of these issues are picked up in its most recent report, and we would entirely endorse the points that are made across that report about the priorities for the forthcoming review. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm going to move to questions from the committee. I'll bring in Mr. Stewart first.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, members of the panel. In your opening question there, you've all talked about the challenges and how business has had to adapt. And business has adapted. We've also gone out and visited some sectors ourselves and the committee. But what we have found, and I think you're saying similar, is that for some businesses, the step has been too far for them to continue, and they have chosen to maybe rely on the UK market and try and find new businesses within that context to try and fill the gap. And for other businesses who've not managed to progress, they've just not continued to trade with the EU. It's become far too complicated. It's become far too bureaucratic. It's become far too costly. And that is the flavour that, once again, I think we're getting from most of you today about how the difficulties, and interesting that you Catherine, mentioned the media in the perceptions and the realities that are happening out in the sectors and out in the world that the media portray. And that has had an impact on all business confidence as well as the trading. But when it comes to skills, and when it comes to finding the people within the business sectors that you all have, you've identified once again that there are difficulties that in ensuring that you get the right people, that they're able to fulfil the roles and the responsibilities. But each and every one of you have indicated that the extra costs, the extra burden that comes into all of this has a real impact on the bottom line for all your organisations. So some have survived and some have gone to the wall because they haven't managed to adapt and change. Others who have seen have adapted. But would it be the case that for all of you, that your organisations and the individuals that you look after and you represent have changed their style, changed their format to ensure that they can be competitive and they can survive? Because without that, there is little hope of this whole thing changing and going forward. So my question to all of you would be, you've given the convener a flavour of what your wishes and your wants are to try and change it. Is there anything from that wish and want list that you really do believe would be the pinnacle that could and might change and adapt for your organisations and your companies to take on board to ensure that you can and you will have the future that you all want to see, which is the prosperity for your organisations and things going forward? Or is it the case that they've had to change and they can no longer go back to the markets and the structure that they had because that is no longer feasible, viable or economically supportive? I don't know who wants to answer first. Well, if I maybe go to Mr. Bain first as the Chamber of Commerce and see what he says. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. Really interesting and an apposite question. I think there are great opportunities if we can reach some of these reforms. So if you look at the recent study from Aston University, which looked into veterinary agreements, and it found that having quite a maximalist one could increase our exports of agri-food to the EU by 22% and also increase imports coming the other way by 6%. So there is, I think, a sort of pent-up capacity to want to export more in agri-food, which an agreement can help relieve and boost. I mean, much depends on the kind of agreement that could be reached. I mean, it's noticeable in some of the EU statements, they see, you know, a very maximalist one, but based on dynamic alignment as the kind of agreement they would be looking to make. Policymakers at Westminster have tended to say they want to see a mutual recognition type of agreement and one that wouldn't involve dynamic alignment with EU food legislation. So there would obviously, you know, you don't get 22% growth in exports with that type of agreement, but the Aston research shows that you do still get some. So I think there is that possibility. I think in terms of the VAT changes, yes, since 2021, some companies moved to rejig their supply and their distribution chains. So for medium and larger companies, they've pretty much done that. But for many smaller businesses, they can't rejig their distribution. And so the practical benefits of having a VAT agreement with the EU and removing that fiscal representative requirement, that would increase trade as well between us. So I think if you look at the art of what is possible and looking to the pragmatic, practical things that would make a difference to business, we are confident that we can see a return to more export levels in terms of goods. And I think it's also important to say that since 2021, there has been an increase in services trade. Most of our services exports are delivered digitally. You know, it's lawyers emailing their advice, it's architects emailing the sort of designs, auditors, accountants. So we have seen quite good and strong growth in services, and Scotland is pretty much to the fore of that. So I think that's another area where we can be confident that we can see growth in the future if we make the right adjustments and build the right relationships with our European partners.
Thank you. Ms. Foster, I mean, you're representing the smaller Federation of Small Businesses, and they have had the biggest hit, we believe. And I think you said that yourself when you gave that. So it would be good to get a flavour of what you think are, as well, the way going forward.
Thank you. I think that's a really interesting question, because obviously the UK is now a third country, and there are steps, processes, requirements that come with that. And there are steps that can be taken to alleviate some of those issues. But, you know, we are no longer in the single market. And so inevitably, there are now going to be things like customs declarations, which are part and parcel of being outside the EU. You touched on businesses changing their models, how they do business. And some of our members have done things like opened a distribution center in the EU. They've looked at bonded warehouses in the EU to make their distribution into the single market easier. But those are very expensive options. And so it's a really small number of businesses who have been able to do that. So I think, and this is similar to the point that that William has just made, is that, you know, I don't think there is one single silver bullet to reduce friction in EU trade, but there are certain, you know, there are a number of things that we think could ease some of those burdens, reduce some of the costs, and just make trade that little bit more appealing and less burdensome for small businesses. And, you know, I won't repeat everything that William said, but it is things like the SPS checks on agri-food products, it's youth mobility, it's removing some of those burdens that for the smallest businesses can be business critical when they're making decisions about where to trade.
Thank you. Catherine?
Again, not wanting to repeat what colleagues have raised, I think in the simplest terms, for me, some of the biggest opportunities are looking at those who have not yet attempted to export, maybe entrepreneurs at an earlier stage of their journey. For me, there's something around really demystifying the process, guidance and procedure and support, and making that as readily available to those who are looking for it as possible. We have heard anecdotally from members that after 2021, there has definitely been a surge in consultants offering expertise in this space, and there is a varying degree of quality of support available. I think there's also something around a general lack of understanding in some isolated but still relevant cases where some, you know, early stage entrepreneurs perhaps don't even recognise that they export or trade out with the UK. We have an example of a member at an event quite recently that was that said they didn't export, they didn't do any of that, despite complaining about the cost of posting a blanket to the south of France about 5 minutes earlier. So I think there's definitely something in understanding. So our kind of my biggest ask would be, you know, really looking at what that support is, what it looks like, and how we can get that kind of communication and messaging out there clearly and consistently.
And finally, Gareth.
Yeah, we've also heard about the adaptations that businesses have made in order to continue to trade with EU markets. Some of those have reduced economic activity within the UK, and obviously we are worse off for that. I think it's not just about those who have adapted. We also hear from businesses about how they have slowed or cancelled expansion plans into EU markets as well. And I think that loss of growth is something that we need to bear in mind as well. Cathy made a number of important points around support for businesses. In relation to what can be done, again, there's no silver bullet here. Clearly, quite a range of our members would like to see action on export health certificates and moving to some form of veterinary agreement with the EU, if at all possible, particularly beneficial to businesses in many rural parts of Scotland, obviously. I think it's important to bear in mind as well, not only how could we make improvements, but also how can we protect what's already there. So in relation to financial services, for example, UK continues to manage two-thirds of EU assets post-Brexit, and that's underpinned by the continuation of the regulatory regime that gives clients globally the confidence to invest in the UK. So we would welcome the fact that those regulatory frameworks remain in force after Brexit, but we're concerned over time that there might be some divergence materially away from them, and that might create some pressures on the UK as a place to do business, for example. So we have to carefully manage that regulatory picture, whether it's active divergence or passive divergence, to ensure that we don't create fragmentation and we cooperate around alignment. Thank you.
Thank you, convener.
Keith, do you want to come in?
Sure. Thanks very much, and good morning, panel. I'm just conscious that the evidence that we've heard from you this morning is both consistent with each other and also consistent with what the committee's heard in this inquiry previously, except in one regard, and I suppose that's really just the strength of feeling. So in the past, we've had individual businesses who are said now to have stopped exporting in Scotland altogether to the EU, some who have gone bust. I think of a small one in Kintyre in particular. Some who have been sought to be taken over by, in one case, a German company, because that made it easier to export to the EU, but pretty strident and negative about their experience. One told us they found it easier to export to Turkey and Russia and China than to the EU now. So that's an immediate drop-off. I think the loss to the UK is meant to be around £140 billion at least. On the last point that was raised by Mr Williams, I think in relation to investment in the UK, we now hear that the City of London, the Stock Exchange, has reduced in size significantly, and that's an ongoing process. So I suppose my question is really, and I know that some of your organisations are the Scottish side of UK-wide organisations, it's just to find out whether you've found a different experience in Scotland, or if it's pretty common throughout the UK in regards to what you've just mentioned. We have, I think, in Scotland had for many years, if there was such a thing, a positive balance of payments, and as far as we export substantially more in Scotland than the rest of the UK does compared to what we import. So I really would just be interested from the point of view of your organisations, if you could say, are there things that we're experiencing common across the UK? So things like that you've mentioned, mobility of labour, is that more pronounced in Scotland or not? So I'd be interested. I'll go to Mr Bain, and welcome Mr Bain. I think the last time we met was on Newsnight some years ago. Nice to see you again. But I wonder if you'd want to come back on those points.
Thank you, Mr Brown. Great to see you again. Thanks for the question. I would say in terms of the labour issue, it is a bit more pronounced in Scotland in terms of our survey returns. What we do is we get quantitative data, but we also have free text responses So we get kind of qualitative data. And so, you know, we have that on a very localised basis, actually, you know, in areas like Ayrshire and Angus within Scotland. So very much the labour issues, I think, are more keenly felt in Scotland. And I would also say that the agri-food export issues are more keenly felt as well. And the sense that the combination of that, plus the customs changes, the VAT changes, have created an environment where some companies feel it's not worthwhile doing trade anymore. And that is very sad, given the quality of product, as we know, which exists within Scotland and the demand that could be met in overseas markets. And recognising exports are good for Scottish businesses. They make businesses more profitable. They increase the potential for investment and for wage growth. So I think these are the areas where you know, we should have our eye on the prize. I would say what we've experienced since 2021 is that it's been a bit of a moving target. We had that first phase where it was the customs declarations, the cost of those, the SPS issues, the VAT issues. So they're still there. But what we found, you know, BCC was doing a lot of work over the autumn and spring over issues that arose in terms of the different sanctions legislation in relation to Russia that the UK and the EU had adopted. And many businesses, for example, in Aberdeen and Grampian and the west of Scotland, who were approaching us saying they were losing business from customers in Germany because they were being required to produce new pieces of paper, mill certificates, to prove the provenance of the iron and steel in the product and that it wasn't sourced from Russia. And so we had to engage FCDO, we had to engage the European Commission to come up with a solution. And we're very grateful that was adopted, I think, at the end of February, which has removed the requirement for this mill certificate. And that's been a big boon to exporters of steel and iron products from Scotland. But so what we're having really is a new series of challenges that are coming up. And I think that speaks to the need to have better processes within the TCA for regulatory cooperation. And what the BCC has called for in terms of traded goods, you know, Mr. Williams talked about the divergence that's happening in services. So in our recent Global Britain report, what we called for was in terms of traded goods that the UK should adopt and align with the primary regulations of the EU in order to cut and mitigate these new costs that exporters in Scotland are going to face.
Thanks for that. And Kate Foster?
Thanks for the question. We have certainly heard from businesses anecdotally that when they're thinking about growth now, there is a move towards, say, the USA, there's a move towards the Middle East. That's where businesses are starting to think about moving when they're thinking about internationalizing, thinking about trade. But Europe is still, as a global region, it is still the top region that businesses want to expand into. When we ask members what their top five, what their top destination markets are for exports, the top five are always France, Germany, Ireland, Netherlands, and the USA. So Europe still, it remains the natural jumping off point, if you like, for SME trade. But it is certainly true that some businesses have stopped. Trade is now less appealing. And I think that pattern is reflected across the regions and nations of the UK. You know, the same issues tend to come up, regardless actually of destination market. It's things like customs paperwork, VAT, the costs, the bureaucracy, the lack of knowledge. And we have heard from members, particularly thinking back to those early days in the first part of 2021, we were hearing particularly from seafood businesses in Scotland. That was a real pain point. When we're thinking about the issues now, again, William's alluded to this, the labour shortage, particularly when we're thinking about rural areas, that is an issue that that businesses are facing across the UK, but particularly in those rural areas in Scotland. But I think, and colleagues have alluded to this as well, this speaks to the broader need, not just to look at the trading agreements with the EU and our other trading partners, but also to look at that broader piece around de-risking trade for small businesses, addressing perceptions, tackling the non-tariff barriers, which are just as important as tariff barriers, whether that is in terms of certification, meeting the upfront costs of Brexit, upskilling your staff so they know how to deal with paperwork, things like that. So it's part of a broader piece of making trade more appealing and building it into a small business's growth strategy earlier on.
Thank you. Catherine McWilliam.
Thank you. Again, not wanting to go over the ground that colleagues have already covered, but in reference back to our Policy Voice monthly survey, that is a UK-wide survey, but we do extrapolate the Scotland data, and generally we tend to find that it's much of a muchness. As IOD Scotland, we carried out our own State of the Nation survey earlier this year, and the results of that indicated that for the third year in a row, access to talent and skills was the number one concern of our members. That being said, within the same survey, two-thirds of our members indicated that they had plans for ambitious or steady growth over the next 12 to 18 months, but in the free text boxes for commentary around concerns and opportunities within that, lots of our members indicated that they were concerned as to the how they would do that.
Can I just ask if, in relation to that point you made about expecting or looking forward to growth, was that them looking forward to growth exporting to the EU, or just generally?
It was general, right. But within some of the free text comments, we then did get into some of the detail about challenges in relation to looking to export to the EU and beyond. We also had people talking about the fact that, again, that lack of access to labour and skills, and the fact that they were reliant on skills coming in from elsewhere, was also something that was of a concern. We also, back in 2022, held a policy forum which looked at kind of skills and talent acquisition. And again, similar conversations were coming out about the need for visas to encourage people to come to Scotland specifically. We're actually having an event on the 4th of June where we're going to be picking up this conversation again, because it is such a concern to members, and we will be producing an output from that as well, which we'll be happy to share with the committee.
Thank you very much. And
I'd like to acknowledge the point that you made around strength of feeling. That was certainly clear to us from businesses at the time, and you know, still the case in many places, many sectors. And obviously, some of these challenges that we're talking about come within that wider context of supply chain issues, post the pandemic, inflation, and so on. We're probably less well placed than the others to comment about differences between Scotland and the rest of the UK, being a Scotland-only organisation. But I mentioned earlier our participation in the domestic advisory group, which covers the whole UK. And you know, it's clear that there are still lots of issues for different sectors right across the UK and different regions and nations of the UK as well. And there's a real desire to have all those issues reflected in improvements to the TCA. I would say skills is obviously still a major concern for our members. We recently, working with the Fraser Valander Institute, surveyed businesses about their priorities for the next general election, and skills and labour market issues came up as the main priority below the need for a strategy to generate economic growth. You know, and clearly those are particularly acute in rural and remote areas of Scotland, as colleagues have already referenced. I think as well it's maybe worth saying that perhaps transport costs have a disproportionate impact on parts of Scotland. Obviously, those costs and the options around transportation are different given our proximity compared to parts of England to the continent. That's certainly been a challenge for businesses across a range of different sectors. I know we're focusing on business today, but I did also want to mention impact on universities as well. And I know there has been an impact right across the UK, but certainly for our members in Scotland, they have very strong concerns around EU staff, around students from the EU and the impact of fewer students on not only their finances but the student experience as well, and concerns around the lack of an adequate replacement for the Erasmus scheme as well. Particularly that the touring scheme may, in some ways, disadvantage pupils from more deprived communities in Scotland. So, I hope I can mention that as well.
Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Ruskell.
I was just reflecting on perhaps some of the challenges that your members have in relation to the loss of free movement of labour across the EU and the UK. And it'd be good to get into a little bit more detail about what would actually work for businesses. So I'm looking here at the application page for the skilled worker visa from the UK government. There's obviously a number of restrictions on this. Your job has to be eligible for the visa in the first place. You have to work for a UK employer that's approved by the UK Home Office. And the minimum salary has to be £38,700 a year, or a higher rate if that's the going rate for the work that you'll be doing. Do those rules kind of work for your businesses, and how would you want to, if they don't, how would you want to see those rules changed, modified, in order for Labour to meet the needs of businesses in the UK? Catherine? Do you want to start?
Yep, of course. And if I may, I'll give you an example that we've got directly from a member.
Yes, please. That seems very useful.
This member is in the construction industry, and they said it will take up to 3 months to get a work permit for each member of staff, and this will cost €345 each. Pre-Brexit, there was an immediate start and no paperwork and no cost. If a member of staff is sick and we need to send another, the jobs stop while the paperwork is processed, or we have to apply for several staff as backup, which is obviously additional cost. The previous requirement was zero. The permit has a good deal of boxes to tick off. Staff must have been with us for 1 year plus. They need at least 3 years provable experience and provable qualifications. The previous requirement was zero. Another said that before Brexit we could attract, this is a medical pharmaceutical company, before Brexit we could attract candidates for both medical writing and account management roles from Europe. Free movement meant it was easy for them to move in and out of the country to live, and having staff with native French, German, Spanish is useful. And since Brexit, we have not had a single candidate. And that's a relatively small employer with 10 to 25 employees. So the cost is really quite prohibitive, and I think the fact that we've gone from no cost to quite considerable cost is one of the greatest barriers. I think there's also something around kind of time, procedure, general regulation, and a lack of understanding as to what that actually entails. Again, I don't want to steal any of Kate's thunder from a small business perspective, but there is something around actually having the skills within your organisation to complete the required paperwork, think about the timescales and the procedures. I suppose that would be kind of our biggest concern there.
Mm. So none of that is driving productivity in UK business, is it?
No.
It's not driving economic growth. It's just bureaucracy, isn't it?
It is.
Yeah, it's a waste of time. Kate, do you want to come in on?
Yes, if I could just add, we know that the vast majority of small businesses recruit locally. They might never have need to use the visa system. But for those that do want or need to recruit international talent, complexity, high fees, the admin requirements that Catherine's alluded to, all disincentivize SMEs looking to international talent. And we know that businesses, particularly say in hospitality, have struggled to fill shortfalls with, now that there are fewer European, particularly young people coming into the UK. So I think we feel that there is a need both to address the complexity in the visa system, but also to support small businesses to look at upskilling the workforce to make sure that they have the skills to navigate these things. There are also training programs in place so that small businesses who want to recruit locally can do so. So it's another very complex piece. But I think overall, if we're referring back to things like the fees and the salary thresholds, those are for the smallest businesses, that they are just not possible to get over.
Okay, so which particular sectors would find £38,700 as a minimum salary problematic?
I think, for example, hospitality would be particularly difficult.
Okay, any other sectors that struggle with that?
I am happy to follow up in writing, and we've got data, more detailed data on that I can speak to colleagues and send up afterwards.
Thanks, that's good. Gareth.
Thank you. Just on that last point, we've certainly heard concerns around the minimum salary threshold in relation to early stage researchers at universities. So the kind of people that would be coming in conduct research, and the proposed salary level being at too high a level for them. And obviously we have concerns then about the wider economic impact of that, if it's going to reduce the competitiveness of research and innovation within Scottish universities. So that would be one other example. And I think it's important to make that point that these kind of post freedom of movement challenges exist within a wider concern about the appropriateness of the current immigration system and the changes that have been made to that for the Scottish economy. I won't touch on some of the details of the challenges that have already been faced, but I think it's important to say that many businesses are very alive to, as Kate said already, the need to both do more to ensure that the existing workforce is healthy and productive, and to work with partners, including in the education sector and the employability sector, to recruit people who, for a range of different reasons, are out with the labour market. But that's going to take time. These are challenges that certainly cannot be solved overnight. So we do need to have an immigration system that supports our economy and our wider benefits as well, as we all know, to a diverse workforce, including in relation to skills that our exporters are particularly looking for.
Okay, thanks. And then finally, William.
Russell, I think what Chambers would say is that we look forward to a sort of wider review from the Migration Advisory Committee about all of these thresholds and visa processes. What we did in the last 2 years particularly was put representations to them that you know, the definition of what came within, you know, the sort of shortage occupations list wasn't wide enough, because we're seeing problems in relation still to food manufacturing, selection and picking of fruit and vegetables as well. And of course, the threshold under the skilled route is way beyond, you know, the likely salaries for those sectors. So we're still seeing problems in terms of food production and manufacturing, and that's not got to be forgotten in all of this. I think it's clear since 2021 there has been an increase in skilled migration, and some of the recent changes from the UK government in policy there are designed to perhaps limit the amount of that which is coming into the UK. But alongside care, hospitality, health, we also have manufacturing and food sectors. And that's why, you know, we need to see a sort of wider review of the system by the Migration Advisory Committee and the right decisions taken by policymakers.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Bibby.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel, and particularly like Mr. Brown, good to see Mr. Bain. My question really was to, in relation to Prosper's written evidence, but I wonder if there's other reflections from other panel members as well. In the Prosper evidence, Mr. Williams, you've said that many respondents reported challenges due to differing implementation of TCA by EU states or authorities. Some of these appeared to be due to a lack of understanding of the rules. There was a perception among some respondents that some states or authorities were being more deliberately unhelpful. I just wanted to kind of ask you for some further details on that in terms of what states in particular, how unhelpful, and what motivations there were behind that, and also if the rest of the panel have any reflections on that evidence.
So I'll have to cast my mind back a little bit, because that was in the report that we produced a couple of years back on the initial impact. I think there was at the time a specific issue that had arisen in Italy in relation to imports of goods and the interpretation of the rules. It was actually quite a positive case study in many ways, because there was collaboration between Scottish Government, SDDI, and UK Government, working with industry to address the challenges that had arisen in that case, and certainly improvements were made as a result. You know, anecdotally, we had heard of differing approaches at different ports, for example, in France, but I would have to get back to you on some of the more specific details. I think, you know, there continues to be a general issue around the sort of follow-through of different agreements. So without knowing the ins and outs of that, at the most recent meeting of the Domestic Advisory Group, there was reference to the agreement on legal services and a particular challenge in how that is being interpreted by Greek authorities, for example. So I'm afraid I can't give you any more information than that.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for that answer. You mentioned some of the issues have been progressed and there's been work to resolve the issues. You've also, Prosper, laid out six key actions that the that were required work on, and I noticed from the evidence you've welcomed the positive progress in relation to some of these actions. The number of points are solely for the UK government and obviously industry and regulators. There were a couple of points that were related to Scottish and UK governments, as well as industry, one around working with industry to capture and act on trade frictions, tasking government overseas offices with resolving trade frictions, sharing examples of successful actions, also engaging positively with the EU on policy development and impact, scaling up Scotland House Brussels engagement with EU institutions and Scottish industry stakeholders, facilitating a programme of regular policy missions from Scotland to EU institutions. I just wanted to ask you, specifically in relation to the actions that the Scottish Government can or should be taking, what progress has been made in relation to those key action points that you've made, what's that resulted in practice?
Covering the the last couple of actions first. We ourselves took a policy mission to Brussels last year with representatives from a range of different sectors, and had very good engagement with Scottish Government representatives, Scotland Europa, and UK Government representatives out in Brussels as part of that pilot mission, including introductions to different EU institutions, but also third country representatives as well, to start to get a sense from the Canadians, Norwegians, and so on about how they approach engagement with Brussels. So clearly, there was a learning process for us, and I think similarly, learning process for Scottish Government. We continue to engage with Scottish Government on issues as they arise, and we're looking at taking a second mission to Brussels later this year, potentially with some involvement from Scottish Government Minister in that. And also, we're aware that Scotland Europa is relaunching its Insight Europe programme for Scottish organisations to help bring more of them up to speed on the latest developments within EU policy making and strengthen our relationships with a range of actors in Brussels. As regards trade frictions and so on, I think we have seen evidence of action there, and obviously in the subsequent evidence session this morning, you're going to have a chance to talk with Scottish Enterprise. So I would say that perhaps they would be able to give you more details on those. But we continue to see, actually, at an operational level, pretty good information sharing between Scottish and UK governments around some of these big challenges.
Thank you. I don't know if Catherine or the other panel members have got any thoughts on actions the Scottish Government could be taking to improve these matters.
Just really to agree with what Gareth has already laid out, and go back to that earlier point about just communication and getting the word out there to those that maybe are not aware of the opportunities that sit within export to the EU. I think there's a big communication opportunity here, and I think the Scottish Government can be front and centre with that.
And Kate or William?
Nothing further to add, really, just to echo the importance of keeping the channels of communication at all levels, political and technical, keeping those channels open.
Thank you. William, do you have anything to add?
Thanks, Mr. Bibby. I would say that, obviously, since 2021, there's been a particular challenge about the kind of relationships that business needs to have, and particularly business representative organisations, in order to deliver for our members with all of these issues that are coming up. We've talked about the issue about the steel sanctions and how that caused an issue. We've got to remember the relationship is evolving. You know, there's new regulation coming from Brussels, which the UK is, in some cases, passively or actively diverging from. But there's also the compliance costs and efforts for business and all of that as well. And that means that we as business organisations have got to have really strong relationships with the embassies in the UK and the consulates in Scotland. We've got to, you know, build a different kind of relationship with the EU institutions as a third country now. And it's a more complex picture, but it's really important because when you think about the practical issues that are emerging, whether it's going to be CBAM, deforestation regulation, supply chain legislation coming forward, packaging legislation, business, parliaments and governments, whether at UK level or devolved level, have got to engage and work with businesses and EU institutions and member states to get the right solutions for businesses here.
Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any further questions? No, I wonder if I could have a final question. Mr. Bean, I think it was you that talked about the political will to get this resolved earlier on. Previous deputy convener, myself, are regular attendants at the PPA as observers from the Parliament. And we've seen attention there about what the review will actually mean. And, and very hard line from some European members saying, you know, they're not opening it back up, you know, and this is, you know, it's a performative piece of review rather than these opportunities. And obviously, and you all know this from your work, your work relationships are key in Brussels and the way it operates and things. So I just wonder if you get a sense that there is a political will there to try and resolve some of the issues you've raised with us today.
Very strongly. We need to obviously wait and see, get beyond the political cycles this year, both in the European Parliament election and the Westminster election. But beyond that, I think there are some real causes for hope and positivity. Whatever people think of the timing, it was interesting that the EU itself produced a proposal on mobility. I think we're also seeing post-Windsor framework adoption last year, some real improvements in the relationship, UK associate membership of Horizon Europe and Copernicus, cooperation now in supply chains on semiconductors. So there is an improving relationship. To take it to the next level, I think we've got to bear in mind the EU will only do those things that it sees in its interests. And so what we are doing as a Chamber of Commerce in the UK is working very closely now with Eurochambre, our European counterpart, because it's having, in a sense, that common interest from both sides, making sure that government at Westminster and the European Commission and the Member States get the common benefits there will be from improving this relationship in the areas that we've set out during this session. That's going to be the thing that delivers the progress. So I would say that's probably the most important thing that those of us in the business sector can do is to work with the DAG is very significant and is producing some great work, but also to work closely with our European counterparts, because that's the way that we can get that political will in place to get to the kind of agreements that will make a practical difference to trade.
That's helpful. Thank you. Kate, do you want to comment on that question?
Yes, I think I'm going to echo a lot of what William has just said. I think it is noticeable how the relationship has changed in tone over the last few years. A lot of that, you know, is down to things like the Windsor framework. We are now in a place where, you know, it's a much warmer political relationship. It's allowing some of the space underneath the policy, and the technical work to get done, which is really, really critical to removing some of those frictions and some of the behind the scenes work that is really important to making trade flows smoother. I think We too are a member of a European Federation, SME United, so we are very focused as well on the issues that are common to European SMEs, because despite the fact that the UK is now a third country, the issues that SMEs across Europe and in the EU raise, they are by and large the same. They are to do with things like bureaucratic administrative burdens, the cost of doing business. They are all common interests. And so it's really important for us to stay part of that network and those conversations. As William alluded to as well, the diplomatic relationships are really important. So it's keeping the conversations going at all levels. It's making sure that the political relationship remains in a good place to allow the policy and the technical work to happen underneath.
Thank you. Catherine, you have any thoughts?
I'm not actually close enough to these conversations to be able to provide a worthy comment, but very happy to follow up with my colleague in London who is and provide something in writing.
That was very helpful. Gareth?
I agree with everything that's been said. Just to add, I suppose, that when we were in Brussels last year, it was clear that there's still a strong respect for Scottish and UK strengths in business, in academia, and in policy making. We're dealing with many similar challenges around tech, around the climate, around generating growth, not least in relation to warding off some of the challenges on debt, for example. So there is a lot that we can offer, potentially. And I think if we make ourselves open and available to decision makers in Brussels, and we look for areas of collaboration, there is scope to go further. That's not to say that the review is currently even in the top five priorities for the EU, but it's our job to try and make sure that it becomes a higher priority and we make as much progress as possible. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. I think that's exhausted questions this morning for our first panel. Thank you all for your attendance this morning. It's been really helpful. I'll now suspend for 5 minutes while we change the panels over. Thank you. So a warm welcome back to our session this morning, and I welcome from Scottish Development International, SDI, Jan Robertson, Director of Global Trade, and Ewan Cameron, Head of Global Trade and Consumer Industries. Welcome. And we're joined online by David Decroc, Team Leader, Energy Transition Trade Europe, Middle East and Africa, and Senior Representative France. So a warm welcome to us, to everyone. If I could just start with a question on the approach to supporting Scottish business at the moment. You'll have heard and probably reviewed some of our evidence sessions, and what small business in particular seems to be wanting is a much more structured support in terms of a toolkit around being able to do trade. That's been mentioned, and the challenges around the costs and consultancy. So I'd like to get just a flavour of what you're doing at the moment, and if I could maybe just start with Jan. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you very much for the opportunity to come along today and provide evidence to this important inquiry. In terms of your question, yes, so we are very much focused on supporting businesses. We've been, just to go back a little bit, as you can imagine, in the run-up to the TCA, we provided a lot of support as well. We started that provision of support back in 2016. And since then, our support has really been focused on listening to businesses. We are very in a very fortunate position. We work with a wide range of businesses of all sizes, both SMEs and large companies, and we also work across a range of sectors. In particular, we support companies across the consumer sector, that's food and drink and textiles predominantly, science and technology, and also energy transition. So our work has really been listening to those businesses, and also in particular about the realities they're facing, and obviously that's what we've been discussing a lot today. So that support has been about really providing specific support to companies. So when we've heard what companies need and want, what challenges they're facing, we've been very much reacting to that, also trying to proactively consider what challenges might be around the corner, and there will be some of those as well. And the support has very much been that, so a mixture of things really. So first and foremost, that one-to-one support with companies. Some of the challenges they face will be very specific to them as a company in the sector they're in. But then also that kind of what we call kind of one-to-everyone support. So before, in the run-up to the TCA, we had on our website, we had a Prepare for Brexit website, which did very much include such things as toolkits. So really helping companies look at, take a kind of diagnostic approach. So put in the information that's relevant to them, and that diagnostic would really help them consider what they needed to do as a company to take steps to address the challenges that might be around the corner for them. We also had a Prepare to Brexit checklist that was used a lot as well, the diagnostic tool, about 8,000 companies used that. And more generally, on our website, we had 220,000 visits to the website, 465,000 views. So just giving a sense of how well that was used. And we've continued. It's not a kind of one and done. Once the TCA came in, we then obviously went to the next stage, Prepare after Brexit. And now more recently, we've now got the UK border strategy on there. So it's a very much a continuation of that support. And other point I would make is doing that in conjunction with others. So while we provide a lot of that support, you've heard from others on the committee today, we very much provide that support in conjunction. So signposting to other support options, whether that be DBT, Export Academy, or memberships organisations who also provided a lot of support. So it's really, it's that one-to-one support plus that kind of one-to-everyone. And also what we did also is kind of one-to-many. So what we found very useful is that peer-to-peer support. Some of this learning is companies learning from each other. So through that, we have webinars, for example, peer-to-peer roundtables, particularly doing deep dives into sectors. For example, we did one around shellfish, where I think the committee might have heard there has been some particular challenges, and also some online kind of learning as well that we take companies through, just to try and provide that rounded support that we know companies are looking for.
Ewan, do you want to add anything?
Well, the sector I lead is consumer industries, so I'm responsible for the trade advisors we have based in Scotland and the trade advisors we have in markets overseas. So as Jan says, a lot of the work we do is providing one-to-one support
to businesses. So in the sectors I'm responsible for, that's food and drink, textiles and the wider consumer lifestyle. And we've got trade advisors that provide one-to-one support to approximately 350 companies. And the role of the international trade advisor is then to be building connections with food service buyers, retail buyers internationally, sharing insights on what the international opportunity is, and then supporting the trade advisor in Scotland to then support that company to access the particular markets.
So you said 350. Out of those 350, how many would you class as sort of SMEs?
So quite a number of the businesses that we would support in food and drink and in the textiles area will be SMEs. Many of the companies in these sectors are small, medium-sized businesses, family-owned businesses. There are some large companies in that portfolio, but I would say the sweet spot in terms of where we can add support is in the SME group.
Thank you. That's helpful. David?
Yes, thank you very much. Can you hear me well?
Yes, we can. Thank you.
Fantastic. So I'm based in France, so greetings from sunny Paris today. Really delighted to be here with you. So I'm one of the field members at SDI. I'm heading up a team which is focusing on the energy transition and supporting our companies doing business in the fields of renewables, offshore renewables, hydrogen across Europe, Middle East and Africa. Our role is really to be at the forefront of the Scottish economy in markets. And as Jan alluded to, we work a lot on a one-to-one basis with companies, supporting them throughout their journey. I think one important part of the role being in market is also to be the voice of Scotland, to be the ears and eyes of the Scottish economy in those markets, understanding what the mega trends are, being able to establish connections, build networks, and being able to put ourselves in a position whereby we can use those networks to the benefits of our companies or SMEs and to the Scottish economy. That's in a nutshell how we support, and I'm sure we'll get the chance to get back on those and provide more examples.
I'm going to move to questions from the committee. Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, convener, and good morning. You've talked about access, and access is vitally important. We've already heard about the barriers and the bureaucracy that is creating some friction. But it would be good to talk about the networks that you're trying to involve so that you can try and all break down some of those barriers. Now, we've heard in the past about technology that might be there to support some of you in creating some of that. We've also talked about the business mobility and how the mobility issues and what might be required to try and tackle some of the mobility issues and where the technology and databases and infrastructure comes in to try and support. So it would be good to get a flavour of if you see that as a way forward, or is that once again still another barrier or still another problem to your organisations when you're trying to do that? Because all of that comes at a cost. And we've heard today that cost and marketing and managing the costs are vitally important to ensuring that your businesses can thrive and can survive in this difficult economic situation you find yourselves in. So a flavour of that would be useful. Thank you. And maybe, Jan, if you can start.
Thank you. And absolutely, it's all about how do we help the companies we work with kind of thrive. And just to give a bit of context to that, so we work with nearly over 2,000 companies, and 60% of them, they still want to target Europe. So I think it's really important. Europe is still seen by the companies we work with, the portfolio, as the most important market to them. And so our support is very much focused on how do we help them access that more. And as you've pointed out, so networks is an incredibly important part of that. That's one way we do it. And we do that in a number of ways. Because trade, ultimately, it's a business about people. It's a people business. So first and foremost, it is those relationships that we are building as a team. As David said, so both from our specialists in Scotland, we've got 41 of them in Scotland. We've got 69 around the world, and a third of them are in Europe. So those that are in the EU are very doing that much, helping companies there. So in terms of our networks, it's our team, first and foremost, is that network. So we help the companies in Scotland get ready to export, help them put in place a plan to export to the EU, and then help them build those networks overseas. That might be with buyers, so introducing them to a number of buyers, hold Meet the Buyer events, which can be very important in terms of, one, trying to find where that sale is going to be, but start to really address those challenges and talk about how they are going to export. We also use networks such as Global Scots, so we've got 1,300 of those around the world, and they also play a very important part. For example, we've got a Global Scot in France, in Paris, who spends a lot of time with companies talking about those barriers, what they might do to set up a premises overseas, whether that be in France, whether that be in Netherlands, which is quite popular for many companies now, and just how to address some of those non-tariff barriers. We also work, our staff are co-located with the FCDO, so UK government and other partners across government. So very much that kind of team effort, trying to unblock any of those barriers for companies as well. So it's those multiple networks. And I guess touching a bit on, I think it was the last question, the last committee session, the role of ministers in that. So as a team, what we also do is support ministerial visits out to market, and they play an important role as well, both having those discussions with partners. Some of that is government to government, and that's an important role in using that network as well. And the final one I would say is events. So as a team, we run many events around the world, and still a good number of those in the EU. We ran 38 events last year across the world, and I see a good number of those in the EU. And that is very much creating a network for companies. So when companies go out there, they get to meet buyers, they get to meet importers, distributors, and that helps build the networks. And back to the previous committee session, it's kind of de-risk it for companies. So there's individual challenges, but if we can raise those ambition levels, remove some of those barriers, make trade more accessible, all of these things, they don't necessarily go away, but they do make things easier for businesses. So I'll say that.
Thank you.
Ian, you want to add anything more?
I can maybe give you some examples specific to food and drink. I know you've had evidence from Seafood Scotland, Salmon Scotland and others previously. So in terms of how we support companies to do exports, we do it very much in collaboration with Scotland Food and Drink and the other trade associations. In fact, 19 of the 19 in-market specialists that are part of my team, 11 are co-funded through an arrangement between a number of industry partners and Scottish Government and Scottish Enterprise. So we actually jointly discuss the types of opportunities that we see in overseas markets. And this is a great way of getting industry input into the work that we do. And using our networks internationally is critical to supporting businesses to export. And a lot of the work that in-market specialists are doing, you know, they've got their own connections with regulators and other departments overseas. They're sharing insights back to Scotland about what the opportunities are. Jan mentioned events there. Mm-hmm. So one of the events that we delivered recently was Seafood Global in Barcelona, which is the biggest seafood show in the globe. So you've got buyers, happens to be in Barcelona, but you've got buyers from all over the world coming mm-hmm. to that. So you know, we're engaged with a number of partners to deliver that type of event.
Fantastic. And David?
Yeah, very quickly, I don't want to repeat what my colleagues just said, but from an international perspective, I think it's also important to remind ourselves that in the early days of the TCA, we were still in COVID lockdown with very limited possibilities to travel, especially for our companies. And this is where being in country, building those networks, building out those contacts in the different industries that we cover, alongside our colleagues from the FCDO, from DBT, was very crucial at the time to allow us, you know, when the travel restrictions were lifted, to be as effective as we could. And indeed, during the period of COVID, being able to deliver online activities for our companies. Because what is really important in the international business is being on the radar of the important buyers across Europe. If they don't see you, you don't exist. So that is, I think, a very, very important message, or a very important thing to keep in mind.
We also had discussion this morning about the media coverage and the perceptions and the realities out there in the marketplace. Do you see that as a problem when the press and the media choose to put something out there that maybe gives an impression, either good or bad, about how the situation is?
Yeah, definitely something that we need to keep in mind and to have a close look at. The coverage, and probably I'll be a bit biased because I was in France, and I'm still in France. And France, as you know, was probably a hardliner amongst the EU states when it comes to the TCA negotiation. So indeed, the press coverage at the early days of Brexit, of the TCA, was pretty difficult. And again, our job was to explain that there are still possibilities to work with the UK-based companies, that we are preparing our companies to the requirements, to match up with the requirements that the EU and the UK have agreed on. But definitely that is something that we had to work with. The good news is that over the past few years, I think the relationship has improved, and as a consequence, the media reports are, I guess, a bit more positive. So that's really good. In the energy space, I can mention a few examples. I think a couple of weeks ago, there was a joint declaration between the UK government and the Germany government about looking at the feasibility of a hydrogen pipeline between the UK and Germany. And these are signals that are sent to the business communities that things are improving, that although we now operate under the TCA, we are still able to build meaningful relationships. And I think that is a message that the industry in Europe is receiving loud and clear.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Brown.
Thank you, and good morning and happy Europe Day, panel. I should say that my view has always been that we should have stayed in the EU, as was true of the majority of people in Scotland. But now that we're out, this inquiry has heard from a number of previous witnesses that we've had businesses in Scotland go bust. We've had ones which have stopped exporting altogether. We've had ones which have been taken over by, one example, a German company, so they could continue to export with slightly less friction to the EU. We've also heard that it's harder now for some companies in Scotland to export to the EU than it is to Turkey or Russia. And also last week we heard from a witness that said, from Northern Ireland, that said the UK is rapidly becoming the most expensive place in the world to do business. Given all that, I just wonder, the work that you do in trying to boost exports for all the benefits that brings, it would be good to get an appreciation of what do you think you can achieve, how much of it is structural and is not going to change in terms of the frictions. We've not even really seen a lot of the frictions bite yet, we will do shortly. How much of it is structural that is not susceptible to encouraging businesses to export more? It's always going to remain at a competitive disadvantage. Or conversely, how much of it is susceptible to doing things differently, improving what we do and overcoming those structures? I don't know if that makes sense. Just try to get an idea of what the extent of the possible is in relation to this, and if I can maybe come to Jan first.
Yeah, I think there's two parts to that, isn't there? So I think I believe there's some of those structural things that that are there. We can't ignore the fact that there is friction, and as we've kind of talked about throughout the committees, you know, that will change. It's not kind of one and done. The TCA is there, but it will change over time. We've also got the change coming with the border target operating model as well. And I think it's absolutely fair to say that is creating challenges. We did see the groups of companies that we work with, we did see trade with Europe fall quite dramatically. It's now started to increase and sales last year, when we look at the companies we worked with, the majority of those sales did come from the EU. We've fortunately not seen, with the group of companies we work with, we haven't seen so many the failures that were talked about this morning. We've not had experience of that, and I'll explain why I maybe think that is the case. We definitely have seen companies come out of Europe because it's just too expensive, it's just too difficult. Now, some of that is definitely problematic, but there has been some positives to that, because back to your bigger question, you know, what does this mean for Scotland and trade overall? Because we do want to grow trade. We are the key delivery partner of delivering a trading nation. That's got ambitions to raise export to 25% of GDP. And we're still positive about tracking towards that, about achieving that. And I say that because what Scotland has to offer are products and services, particularly in new and emerging sectors such as energy transition, that has been mentioned, the strength of our food and drink sector and their emerging science and tech sector, things like space, quantum, all areas that are becoming more and more demand, and Scotland is very much at the forefront. So I think there's a lot to be positive about. And there's things I think we can address there, and this was kind of mentioned in the last session. It's about that accessibility, but it's a few things. It's about ambition raising, and I think we've got more to do in that, and we've got a role to do that alongside others. We've got 14,800 exporters in Scotland at the moment, but we need more, and we want those existing exporters to do more as well. And then there's a capability piece. So how do we help those exporters do more? One, to export first of all, and then export more. So I think there's more we can do about, one, raising those ambition levels, and two, helping companies get ready to export. And that's things like skills. We've talked about that a bit today. Some of that, a big part of that, is capacity. So we find more and more, particularly in the food and drink sector, huge demand for our products in that sector. But we need to be able to provide the quantums that are required, and some of that is about investment. If you look at Scotland, in terms of capital investment particularly, we're kind of lagging in OECD terms. And for exporters, that's incredibly important, because we need to be able to provide those products. So we need more investment. And some companies actually, is it a slight silver lining? Maybe too positive to say that. We have seen some exporters as a response to what's happened with the TCA. And there's, in particular, around that inability, the reductions in the freedom of movement of labour, is invest more. So while that, and of course that has a cost, and of course that is going to be some short-term impact, hopefully it should have that longer term. And I think that's incredibly positive, because what we see, the EU will remain a strong, strong partner, and where most of our companies want to export to, but we're seeing much more ambition and interest moving east, so particularly around the Middle East, the UAE in particular, and out in Indonesia, in Singapore, and Malaysia, for example. We are putting additional staff out there because we're seeing much more demand. Now, that's new and different. We didn't see that years ago, because it's always harder to export there. It's more costly, it's more complex. But companies are, one, seeing the opportunity there. We will see exports grow throughout the UK more to the east. So I think that's something we absolutely kind of need to support. The friction will be there. I think so it's a two-pronged attack. I think actually it's helping companies realise their total global ambition, looking at it holistically, and also doing everything we can to address those challenges that are there. And hopefully over time they'll ease, but we've not got that crystal ball. We're not quite sure how they will change over time.
Before I come to Mr. Cameron, just to come back on that point about, first of all, capital investment, I would imagine that's partly tied to the fact that previous exporters, will see diminishing returns, the fall-off in EU trade, so the ability to, or the willingness to invest more in capital is probably tied to what their perception of the returns would be. But in relation to what you said about the growing trade in Indonesia and elsewhere, is that because the differential previously between exporting to the EU and those areas didn't make it attractive or as attractive just to trade with the EU, and it's now become more attractive, even if it's not become any cheaper, if you follow what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely, you're right. So we obviously we'd kind of more friction-free trade with the EU. Now the TCA we don't, so we're now that is now more compatible to other markets. So I think partly it's that, partly is there is growing demand. So there's demand now there that wasn't there several years ago. And we do expect that to increase, particularly driven by consumer trends going east, middle classes kind of growing the demand for our products and services. And then also, I guess, you know, playing to Scotland's strengths. So, for example, if I give an example, in Malaysia, we've got a huge opportunity around the space industry because Malaysia have noticed what we're doing in Scotland. They have got a particular need to use our downstream technology. So it's playing to Scotland's strengths is also what's driving that interest going east as well.
Thanks very much, Mr. Cameron.
Yeah, so I'd maybe I'll comment again specifically to on consumer industries, and I'll try and avoid covering anything that Jan's covered. But I would say after Brexit, particularly my team, the trade advisors on my team, we're providing a lot of one-to-one support to businesses, helping them understand processes, paperwork, documentation. While they might not... sorry. Take a drink of water. So while the trade specialists might not be experts on the technical bits of information they need to find out for the company, you know, we can provide guidance and access to Institute of Exports or other technical experts. So I would say in the 18 months after Brexit, that was what my team was engaged in doing, supporting companies to navigate all these things. I think for certain sectors, the companies have now become quite familiar with all the documentation and the processes. So, for example, David was talking earlier about France. So our seafood sector, our salmon sector and our red meat sector have got a fantastic reputation in France. So they are going to still do business there, despite the challenges with the TCA, etc. The difference might be fine foods, premium grocery type products, where the EU might be able to get these products cheaper within the EU. And we've heard sometimes from the French saying, well, we may not look to buy these types of products from Scotland, maybe as much because they're more expensive because of various different additions and cost. But it's about supporting companies navigate through that. We have had some companies that have said to us, just because they're small, you know, they're very small, and they don't have the resources required to spend. Because remember, a lot of companies, food and drink companies in Scotland, they don't have the resources available to have a dedicated export manager. It might be someone who's also dealing with the UK market. Some of these companies have decided perhaps to focus on the UK. But others have said, where normally the EU would be their first step, they are now considering the Middle East equally as the EU because they believe they can do some really good business there. So we've been doing a lot of activity, particularly on food and drink, I would say, in the Middle East, to support companies with the opportunities over there, while making sure we still are raising the profile of opportunities within the EU.
Thanks very much. And I'll come to David. I'll not try to pronounce your second name. I wasn't here to hear you being introduced, and I'll probably mispronounce it. But I wonder if it's possible. It'd be really interesting to hear from your perspective, though, on the particular point of what do you think is now structural built-in that's not going to be able to be overcome for companies, in particular, in our case, from Scotland, and what is susceptible to the work that some of the organisations that are here are doing to improve things?
Yeah, thank you very much for the question. I guess that from the energy perspective, it is important to remind ourselves that EU is not a commodity market. It is a market which will only accept high value-added products and services. And in Scotland, we're happy enough to have a very, very qualified supply chain to do so. The TCA, from a European perspective, put the end to uncertainty, to a period of 4 years where companies did not know under which rules they would be dealing with UK-based companies. I think the implementation of the treaty allowed European companies to be a bit more relaxed with working with Scottish supply chain companies. I will give you an example. We were discussing with a major European company which manufactures offshore substations for offshore windmills. This company, we reached out to them before the implementation of the TCA just to have a discussion about what are their requirements in terms of supply chain, how can we provide them with Scottish capabilities. And the answer was, for the moment, we don't bring in new supply chain companies from the UK because our procurement system will categorize them as risky businesses to work with. So unless we have a really good reason to work with those companies, then we prefer to look at other sourcing areas in Europe principally. That has really changed since 2021. And since then, we've been engaging with most of the major players in the energy space in Europe, and all are always very, very keen to hear about Scottish companies and capabilities. With one very important aspect, though, is that those companies need to bring something additional to the table in terms of innovation, in terms of cost competitiveness. So it is really, I think the TCA has created a threshold effect whereby companies that before that were, you know, just about to be profitable in Europe weren't after the introduction of the TCA because of the administrative burdens that have been generated by the TCA. So I think all in all, that there are still major opportunities, but that requires companies really to be very clear on what their unique selling points are, to be really looking at all the innovation they can, you know, bring at the table. And we've had some really interesting successes, including with SMEs from Scotland being very, very successful in Europe. So one of the examples that was publicized a few months back is a small company called Verloom, 30 people, and they've managed to win an order with a major German project developers for a project in the Netherlands. So it is still possible, and I think as long as companies are innovative, as cost competitive, there is a space for Scottish companies in Europe, but it is not a commodity market, that's for sure.
Can I just very briefly ask for a brief response to the point? And from what you've said, the opportunities will, by and large, depend on how the EU defines what's in its interest. If it's a particular sector or service that it wants, then it may choose to make that easier. Because it's in its interest to do so. That seems to me to be logical, I think. Is that right?
Yeah, well, I'm really looking at those discussions from a business point of view. So what is in the interest of a European business as opposed to what is in the interest of Europe? But I guess those are, to some extent, aligned.
Thanks.
Mr. Ruskell?
Yeah, thanks. David, I wanted to stay with yourself, actually, and ask you about, you know, those big policy drivers towards decarbonisation, and in particular the, you know, the impact of the carbon border adjustment model and the integration of emissions trading schemes with the UK, EU, Switzerland. Do you have any reflections on, you know, where there are barriers at the moment towards more efficient carbon markets, and what do you see as the kind of likelihood of potentially bigger markets, more integration across Europe? That's a big question, I know, but
it is a big question. And to be totally transparent with you, I really focus on supporting supply chain companies as opposed to the trading of carbon or energy as a commodity. So I wouldn't be really best placed to give you an answer. What I know, though, is that and what we've been hearing from a few operators across Europe is around the idea that it would be good if the UK and the EU managed to align their ETS systems. From what I understand, there is a divergence between the UK system and the EU system, particularly in the framework of the development of a CCS market, a carbon capture and storage market, which should include the UK at some stage. But my knowledge of this subject matter is too limited to give you a better answer on this one.
That's fine. I'll turn then to Jan and Ewan. Perhaps a slightly different question. I mean, we're now in a phase where there's border checks coming into the UK as well. And, you know, we've taken evidence from a number of businesses that have got supply chains that are running, you know, not just within the UK, but across Europe. So I'm just interested to know kind of how you're supporting with your European colleagues that whole supply chain. Is there now a conversation around, you know, how the existing border checks have been working? What lessons can be learned around import? What are the kind of top tips? You know, whether we're talking about, you know, drivers, whether we're talking about, you know, minimising paperwork, bureaucracy. How do you work together to ensure that business, wherever it's based, wherever it's located within Europe, is able to negotiate and navigate some of the bureaucracy that's been thrown up by Brexit?
Thank you. Yeah, it's very much a kind of live topic, obviously. So a lot of the kind of customs checks and the target operating model coming in a phased approach. So we're working with companies along the way as we do that. And this year, very much working with partners, as you can imagine, that industry bodies, etc. And for us, yeah, it's critically important because, as you've kind of touched on, those supply chains are complex. They're integrated across Europe. They could be kind of wider than that. So our exporters' kind of success is reliant on those supply chains working and working properly. We saw challenges for that during COVID. So I think a kind of positive that came of that is, I guess, companies really understanding and taking more control of that supply chain, understanding it, to have to think how resilient is it. So we've been really working with companies to help them do that, to understand that. That's led to some different decisions where people, they might be kind of nearshoring those supply chains because they're thinking that's the easiest things to do, or they may be diversifying them more. So I think there's, you know, we're working through that with companies. I think there's an important piece about working together, as you've kind of alluded to as well. So when we're working with companies and we're out in Europe, and they're back to the point about the network, we're working with our networks, it's having those conversations, it's being transparent as possible to get that certainty of, well, we know this is coming down the line, how are we going to deal with it, what are the other options? So having contingency planning as well. So it's very much a work in progress because it's a phased approach. And but what we are starting here, I guess a couple of examples where we are starting to hear concerns about companies, because we've got a new, just in April, come in new provisions around particularly goods in the SPS category being designated medium risk or high risk, and concerns starting to come from companies about goods being wrongly designated and then leading to whole consignments being checked that maybe wouldn't have to be checked, and then it holding up consignments, and particularly where there's goods, kind of time-sensitive goods, that is a challenge. So again, it's about, I guess, companies doing their homework, us helping them do that as much as possible and trying to put in any contingency planning around that. Another challenge we're starting to hear is concerns on the EU side where there maybe aren't enough vets in certain countries. So those checks that have to happen again around SPS goods maybe not happening in a timely manner. So it's about companies working through that. And I guess and that relates broader back to your kind of point around CBAM. So I think there's about 20 measures coming in between last year and December this year. So it's our role is very much helping companies keep up to speed with that, trying to understand what's coming down the line. The worst thing that can happen, or what's suboptimal, is that, you know, those adjustments not being made. So we had a great example with CBAM. We had a company, they're exporting, looking to export to Europe, and they've got steel in their product. It's a long kind of sales time, so they need to start thinking it's CBAM now, albeit it's not coming in for a while. And they just weren't sure what to do. So I think there's that piece where companies, there's been a lot thrown at them over the years, mm-hmm. with COVID, with the TCA, lots of measures coming in. So our role is very much to try and keep providing that information, that clarity and that support there to try and help. And that applies to supply chains as well.
Mm. Yeah, you.
Yeah, I'll try and not repeat what Jan said, but in terms of the border target operating model and the checks that have already started on imports, I know that's been done on a kind of risk-based approach. So we will be keeping in touch with companies to offer them advice in terms of perhaps assessing what's a low risk, high risk, medium risk products, because the test for a high risk product, it will be 100% physical checks. For medium risk and low, it will be much lower. So companies will probably be looking for some support about making sure they've got the right commodity code, because if something gets stopped at customs and it's an ingredient they're using as part of their export process, that's going to cause issues for their supply chain. Mm-hmm. So I think for us, it's just working with the companies, reaching out to the companies, listening to them in terms of what the challenges is, and then using our networks. So whether that's our contacts with DEFRA, with our overseas staff, with colleagues in DBT, to help mm-hmm. companies with a solution. Mm-hmm. I'll maybe just give you, if you don't mind, one example on the on the export side.
Please do, yeah.
So, for example, there was a seafood company that we are working with, and through some good work by our in-market specialist in Paris, made an introduction to a European retailer, and negotiations went well. The European retailer was willing to give them a national listing, so this is really positive. And this was around the fact that post-Brexit you need to have a registered EU address on your customer-facing packaging. And there was confusion around whether the retailer's address could be used on the customer's packaging, or whether they had to actually register a business in the EU or identify an importer. So with the trade specialist in Scotland and the trade specialist in Paris working together, we've been supporting that business to find a solution, identify a distributor who would be happy to put their address on and allow that business to proceed. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But they had to renegotiate the pricing a couple of times just because mm-hmm. of the uncertainty there. Mm-hmm.
So. Yeah, yeah. Thank you.
Yep. Thank you. Megan, you want to come?
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning, panel. Just to pick up on the point that you raised there, Ewan, because it's vital the work that you do to support businesses to make sure that these issues can be resolved and resolved quickly to ensure that the businesses can thrive. And obviously, there has been challenges in relation to Brexit, in relation to labour market visas. But I think, in terms of those challenges, they do sometimes present opportunities as well. And I could, I can't help but think, particularly when we're looking at the labour market, the opportunities for the Scottish Government actually to look at its workforce planning to make sure that there's more opportunities, apprenticeships, for example, but also, making sure that young people are aware of opportunities in business, whatever sector they would like to go into. That would maybe help with the depopulation issue that we've got in rural communities, to actually make sure that people are not moving from those communities that are vital into the central belt. So I think that there is a lot of work that can be done, certainly from in here within the Scottish Parliament. But if I can touch upon the CPTPP, I know that's a bit of a mouthful to get out, just in terms of some of the industries that are doing well, just in terms of the expansion of trade agreements, whisky, salmon, just to mention two of them. How I'm supposing I'm getting to the point of Scotland has two governments, so how can both of those governments work better to support businesses post-Brexit to ensure that they are opening themselves up to those new markets through that trade agreement, and to make sure that any of the teething issues that we've spoken about today can be resolved? Well, that's a big question.
I don't want to get into any sort of political comment, because obviously we're an agency of the Scottish Government. The trade agreement that you mentioned does will provide some really good opportunities, and that's the type of thing that we are obviously any new free trade agreements agreed where we want to understand what the opportunity is for Scottish companies. You mentioned challenges around the labour market. I'll maybe just give you a couple of examples on that. And I know that recruitment of labour is a particular challenge, certainly in the food and drink sector, and there's a lot of agencies, Scotland Food and Drink and others, are focused on how we can make the food industry a much more attractive place to come and work. But some of the challenges we've seen recently, post-Brexit, so for example, I know of one red meat company that we support that is bringing in staff from Asia and from Brazil, and they're having to pay £500,000 for 50 staff, so it's £10,000 an employee for sponsorship and visas, etc. And that's obviously a lot of money for one business. I'm also conscious, I was actually speaking to an exporter of premium smoked salmon based in the Western Isles. So they'd been at Showcasing Scotland, which was a big international Meet the Buyer event that Scotland Food and Drink organised with our support in March. This particular customer made some really good contacts overseas. But his challenge is, in the Western Isles, being able to recruit labour is really difficult. They used to have Eastern Europeans. That's now much more expensive and difficult. And he's finding in the local market, he's competing against some of the big salmon processors, for example. So we have got quite a number of the companies that we speak to, labour recruitment is quite difficult. I also know of a salmon processor that's got consistently 50 staff as vacancies, and they're competing with other large suppliers locally to recruit labour. And these issues are a constraint on exports because we need these companies to be able to actually produce. And some companies are actually, we've mentioned automation previously. So I know that some companies in the food and drink sector are now really focused on automation because that's one way they can become more globally competitive.
Thank you. John, I don't know if you've got anything further to
add. No, nothing more to say on that. Thanks.
No. Just in terms of the labour market again, because I do think, I understand absolutely where you're coming from on that point. I just think, that there could be opportunities with the remit that we've got within the Scottish Parliament that we could be looking at this as well to make sure that we are doing everything that we can within the powers of the Scottish Parliamentary remit to make sure that we are promoting the sectors that need labour workers to come in. So we're, again, resolving the depopulation issue that is becoming an issue here in Scotland. So I'm just wondering, in terms of the Scottish Government's devolved powers, what could we be doing to support the labour shortage to make sure that we're getting people into those roles that are so vital for exporting?
If I just come to that. So, again, not to just speak to the politics, that's not what we're here to do, but in terms of what we are supporting, and we can talk to absolutely as an organisation what we are doing, because there are, as you say, kind of pockets where we definitely can see skill shortages. But it's also good, before I kind of talk about those, it's good to reflect on the skills we do have in Scotland. So, and we see that very much from an inward investment perspective. So we're incredibly, we perform incredibly well at that still. So we're still outside London, the second destination in terms of inward investment. And a lot of that is driven by the skills we have in Scotland, and a lot of that coming from the university education that many of our people in Scotland get. So I think we shouldn't forget that. But it's also true that there are some gaps for varying reasons, and as you've referred to. And I think there's some really, so in terms of what we doing as an organisation to help that, we've got a team, Talent Scotland, who very much are focused on that targeted way of trying to get more skills and talent in, particularly into Scotland from overseas. And I should say, it's not a challenge that Scotland alone faces when we're around the world. When I go around and see the team around the world, we know that it is a problem around the world. We know it's an ageing population. So it is that. So in some ways, that's a comfort. It's also a challenge because we're competing globally. And so I think it's important. It's all related to the more we can have those exporters create those good businesses, that growth, that resilience, that itself creates that virtuous circle. So I think there's more we can do around that. We go out, we go overseas to target talent, to sell Scotland, essentially, and very successful at that, but we want to be more successful. We recently went out overseas, particularly to America, to talent. We've got a gap around digital software engineers, and we know that's an area we are kind of looking to address, and had great success in attracting more talent to Scotland in that respect. There's also our networks. So back to the networks point, the universities in Scotland play a key role here, and also what they do overseas. That's one of the networks we also use extensively, the likes of Strathclyde, Heriot-Watt, etc. And that kind of alumni kind of helps with the talent. And the third thing I should say is the government have recently launched their visa service, which again should help address some of that. So I think a challenge we face into, we're not alone in that, but I think there's some really good things we're doing. And I think it's about this continued speaking to businesses. So we're not just addressing the here and now. It's the look forward is really important, so that we are building those skills for the future as well, because that will help exporters build that capacity going forward even more.
That's great. Thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you. Any further questions? Mr Brown?
Just on the last point that was made, my earlier question was about what was structural and baked in and what was susceptible to being changed. And just on the point about labour market, to my mind, we have to be a bit realistic. It's never been tighter. I mean, unemployment in Scotland is very low, below what economists call full employment. So it's even more full employment, if you like. And in the UK, it's also very low. Given that, you've not got a big swathe of unfocused labour that can be deployed to these areas. We don't have it. We have to be, I think, quite frank about that. So really, the way to resolve it would be to try and alleviate the pressures that have been brought in by Brexit to allow more people to come in. Now, I know that's been... Various organisations have made approaches to the UK government to do that, whether it's a particular thing. And, in fact, in Scotland, we had that before under the Fresh Talent Initiative way back in the 2000s, where there was a dispensation in Scotland to attract new talent. Is there any sign of change? I know there's a report came out from the UK this week saying, particularly in the care sector, and I think it might be in the agricultural sector, they have now got chronic shortages. Is there any sign that you're aware of the UK government changing its mind in relation to, for example, the wage barrier that's now there, £38,000 a year? And is it something that you're involved in lobbying for, or is that... No.
No, so not an area we're closely involved in. As a development agency, we focus on... innovation, investment, international, but we don't focus on that kind of migration point. That's other agencies. What I would say, so I agree it is a challenge when we speak to companies about the challenges they face. It's always in the top one, two or three. Cost of doing business is in there often as well. I think the solution is kind of multifold. So yes, that freedom and mobility of labour has made life more challenging in multiple ways, both for goods companies and services companies, and touch on that in a bit. There is a need, I do believe, and back to this capacity point, some of that will be solved by labour, but some of it is this investment piece that we've touched on, that capacity. Some of that solution absolutely is about automation. That's not right for all cases, but it is right for some. And that's important because companies, to really compete, they have to be innovative, as David talked to, but also productive. We know exporters are already 70% more productive than non-exporters. We operate in an even incredibly globally competitive world. It's only going to get more competitive. So some of that will... not all of the solution is people. And I think it also talks to the changing nature of the sectors we're working in. We are moving to more kind of service sectors, more technology sectors. So I think it is a multiple different approach to address the challenges that's, and they are, some of those are still there. I agree.
I don't know if you or David want to come in at all, but that's covered it.
I don't have any further.
Pursuing that sort of line of question a bit more with David, because my impression of the energy sector and that kind of very innovative sector is that it's quite kind of multinational. It's not based in one particular region within a country or whatever where you can, you know, recruit specialists or workforce. It's very much spread across, you know, the across countries and in a thematic way, and the innovation is about collaboration, partnership. But I don't know, what does that sector look like when you walk into a room where there's a group of companies working together in partnership? Is it all people from one place, or is it actually a multinational workforce that's collaborating in different ways?
It is definitely a multinational environment. If we look at the offshore wind sector, I think it's fair to say that Europe has the fair share of the main players there. If you look at the turbine manufacturers, they're located in France, they're located in Denmark. If you look at the developers, you've got developers from across Europe. So it is pretty much dispatched across Europe. Some players in the Americas, some players in Asia, but I think Europe remains, as far as offshore renewables is concerned, which for us is the main opportunity in that, in the energy transition space. we see a very, very European supply chain and a very integrated supply chain. And the role that we have, and back to my opening point, is to be visible and to be seen as credible players in that area and bringing along Scottish companies, some maybe more experienced, alongside more innovative companies, really helps getting a message across and making the case for working with Scottish companies. One thing I would perhaps add, not sure it's super relevant with our conversation, but in Europe, there have been a lot of marks of interest when ScotWind was announced, a massive offshore wind program with half of the capacity around floating offshore wind, which is seen as really, really interesting and promising technology. I think since then, Europe has also announced its ambition, and they're trying to develop 300 megawatt by 2050. So that's 10 times ScotWind. The European supply chain will never be able alone to supply those needs and those requirements, and will need to rely on other countries like, and Scotland has a role to play in those markets. And I think there's a real recognition across Europe that we need to have this collaboration between EU and the UK and Scotland in particular in order to turn those ambitions into reality.
That's the reality about how that massive sector is developing. What does that mean for individuals like yourself who are looking to, go to where the work is? Is that becoming increasingly difficult under Brexit? Is there still flexibility there? Can you find a way through the visa requirements, which mean that you could be working in Paris this year, but perhaps somewhere else?
No. It means that in the early days of the implementation of the TCAs, we had quite a number of companies coming to us, Scottish companies coming to us, because of the difficulties of labour movement. So sending out Scottish workers in Germany or in France to undertake maintenance works, etc., etc. I think it's fair to say that we've managed to orientate those companies in the right direction, talking to the local authorities, the relevant bodies of the different countries to help them navigate those new requirements. And I think most of the companies have now integrated that and factored in this additional burden, administrative burden related to visa requirements. And we don't see that many companies struggling with that. And again, I think there's a recognition that the market needs to be fluid if we want to fulfil the ambitions of the race to net zero.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Any further questions? I wonder if I could just finish on questions around just the challenges that you've laid out there. I mean, we had a visit to Dublin and Ireland as a committee a while back, and the food producers there were talking about, automation and using AI production, machine learning and cobots in production just to stay competitive, on a competitive level with European partners. Special interest for me, I have the Smart Hub at New College Lanarkshire, which works with SMEs in this area. Is there enough understanding, do you think, from SMEs that they're going to have to adopt these innovations going forward? Is it still a challenge to get that message across? The other side of that is, if we are moving towards service industry and different challenges and new emerging technologies, has been, is the strategy behind that for Scotland strong enough, and do businesses understand where that movement is going forward? And then finally, just to touch on it, and I think it was you that mentioned it, Jan, I realise it says sometimes politically controversial, but you talked about how important it was to have the presence there in the networks and the international offices and what they do, and also the importance of the ministerial support for what is happening there. And I just wonder if you could explain more about what that added value is in terms of Scotland's businesses. So I'll maybe go to Jan first.
Yeah, sure. So on those 2 points, the big question, so are companies aware of, I guess, the direction of travel, isn't it, in terms of AI, technology, etc.? I absolutely think there's awareness. There's probably kind of varying awareness across sectors and kind of size of company. And I think there's a willingness, because I think there's a willingness and a desire to embrace it. I think the ability to embrace it and take the steps to embrace it is where it falls down slightly at the moment. And I think that is for a couple of reasons. One, you know, businesses we work with, particularly SMEs, they're busy, they're stretched, there's lots to deal with. We've talked about a lot of that today. Net zero is another big consideration that companies need to prepare themselves as well. So it's definitely on the to-do list in terms of how they embrace it. I think that's a bit, that is challenging. I think how we address that, maybe being a bit more kind of solutions focused, is it's helping companies where we find the gap is understanding that business case, what's the return on investment. So it's often hard, you know, businesses get lots of decisions to make around people, about funding, etc. And I think there's more we can do to help, and we're doing this as an organisation, about helping companies understand, well, if I make this investment, what does that mean? And a big part of that is back to ambition raising, as I said at the start. If companies understand more about, well, what is that global opportunity for me? And there are lots around the world. And what do I do have to get to? What do I have to invest? And what's the return? So it's that whole kind of business case. And it's very hard for companies to do, but it's finding the space and headspace and the skill set to do that. So that's a piece I think we can help companies with. And that's the demand, but the other side is supply. So it's funders are definitely, so when we speak to businesses, all of this costs money. You know, it's investment that companies are thinking about. Some of them are doing, but more need to make. We need to find those funders. And that's something I think we, alongside others, are doing a key role in, is attracting those funders to Scotland and those kind of business propositions. So I think a lot of companies are on that journey, but a bit of a way to go. To your second point around the presence, yeah, that international on the ground presence is incredibly important. As I said at the start, trade in particular is a people business. It's a people sport, as we call it. We do need to get in front of people. And we do that in lots of different ways. And the offices obviously play a key role in that. Some of that is those networks. So we do the role. We're out there for companies. They can't be out in market every day. We've got a team at the 69 around the world. We're meeting those buyers. We're meeting those stakeholders. We're knocking the doors. We're asking the difficult questions to make that path and that accessibility to exports more easier. And we know that that's what companies value. They value that an incredible amount. And related to that is, so it's everything that sits around that. It's not just the day-to-day. It's the events we run. It's the visits we do. And sometimes that does require ministerial visits. That's market-to-market. That can make a really big difference. If I look at the Middle East, for example, the way that market works, it's very government-to-government. And certain, we do need ministers to be in market to unlock certain doors. There are certain conversations that we know just unlock doors. And there's also about, as Dave has talked about, putting Scotland on the map. That is very key. It's a busy market out there. We're very fortunate, Scotland, to have a fantastic brand. We've got a great Team Scotland approach. And part of that is using our offices and using everything we have, really, to make sure that Scotland is viewed positively and we get the most of that from exporting terms around the world.
I can maybe just add something on the productivity or capital investment. So I know within the food industry, encouraging more capital investment is a big focus. So, for example, the new Scottish food and drink industry strategy, they've got one pillar on capital investment for growth. And whenever we talk to exporters now, we're also thinking, we're not just asking them about what markets they want to go into. We've got capital investment in the back of our mind in that conversation. So, are you going to be ready with automation in your factory to secure a big export order? Because capital investment is going to be required if you really want to grow your export markets further. So we do have a big push within Scottish Enterprise in this area, encouraging more capital investment, encouraging companies to think about automation where it's possible. And there's some great examples already in the food and drink industry of companies that are almost, and this is not just in the salmon or the whiskey sector, I'm talking relatively young, new food manufacturers. that they've got it quite highly automated, and because of that, they're able to scale for export markets. So it's, and we need to try and get that message out and encourage and motivate and have case studies to help companies.
Excellent, thank you. David, as someone who's based in France, could you add a bit about what it means in Paris?
Yeah, happy to do that, but probably I'll rephrase what Janet was saying. It is crucially important to show presence, especially in Europe, after the implementation of the TCA, and especially after 4 years of uncertainties for business. So being visible, being able to share the Scotland branding in markets is very, very important, especially in the field. And I'm going back to my sector, energy, where Scotland is seen as a country at the forefront of the energy transition. Scotland was one of the first places to ever operate a offshore wind farm in 2007, I think. And also has a reputation of working or having a real competency and capabilities in working offshore, which makes it very, very, I would say, unique in the, I'd say, the geographical Europe. So really important to be there. Maybe one example I can give: last year, there's a major offshore wind conference taking place in Copenhagen every 2 years, Wind Europe it is called. And last year we decided not to take a stand, not to have a physical presence, but to take a delegation of companies out to market and really focusing on managing introductions and organizing those meet the buyer sessions without having the burden of the stand space. The result was really good in terms of what the companies got out of this this engagement. But the feedback we also had from the market is we didn't see Brand Scotland. Where was Scotland? It was not visible. And that was the message that we received from a few very influential buyers in Europe, which made us think that, yeah, there is definitely a case for raising the flag and raising awareness around the Brand Scotland. On the ministerial visits point of view, in France, as well as in other countries across Europe, the level of representation that you can bring to market can play a crucial role in terms of the doors that you can open as a consequence of those presence. So definitely that is something that can really ease the way for or ease our job, and as a consequence, ease the job of our companies.
Okay, that's super. I think we have exhausted and conscious of time as well. Can I thank you all for your attendance at committee this morning? That's been really helpful. And I'm going to move into private session for a short time. Thank you.